good now. I hope you're doing well. Whoever and wherever you are across the globe, and as you can see here, unless you can't see because you're listening or perhaps you are visually impaired, but I have a model, I guess you'd call it a model, globe, a light up globe. You can plug it in and flick a switch and it will have a nice soft glow to it. And I used this in one other video. I forget what I called that video. Good night world ASMR, I think it was. But this was kind of a last minute idea. I really wasn't planning this. But this is, something, the rock with a molten core on which we live, which is about 73% covered in water. I believe the number is. And I just thought I'd spend a little bit of time here in the beginning talking about this thing that we sometimes take for granted, don't really talk about much in our day-to-day conversations. And then we'll just kind of, stream of consciousness, see where this takes us. And I was just Googling before starting this, how did the water form on the earth or the surface of the earth? And apparently, approximately 4 million or 4 billion, a very large number of years ago, part of the universe, our galaxy, I guess, was in shambles, and all the pieces of the planets that and the moons have yet to form, just bits of rock and dust, eventually all started to become attracted to one another because of the force that we call gravity, the theory of that energy, that massive bodies attract other bodies. And that's how the Earth and all the other planets were formed. And then apparently, the reason that water formed on the Earth or any other planet is by comets or asteroids carrying ice, or at least, at the very least, the molecules needed to create water. And so they impacted the Earth and either deposited the ice that they were carrying onto the Earth, or, as they traveled past the sun, the molecules of ice or gas or however they were being carried or were deposited on these asteroids, heated up, and then eventually as they crashed onto the planet, the molecules evaporated into the atmosphere. And so that's pretty much how the Earth became what we know it as, with the polar ice caps and the water found on the majority of its surface, is by when the Earth was being formed and all the pieces were coming together because of gravity, that all these different asteroids and or comets at least this is the leading hypothesis or theory. You can Google this yourself, just, you know, how did water form on the earth, or do a related search like that on Google, and you'll find a lot of different articles about that. And so all these different bodies, space bodies, comets, and asteroids that were composed of ice or however hit the earth and deposited their ice, or the molecules, oxygen and hydrogen, and that were the building blocks for depositing water and ice on the planet, and the same building blocks which eventually led to the very first types of life as well. So it's quite interesting that literally we are the stuff of space. We are the stuff of stars. That's just molecules brought together, hydrogen, oxygen, atoms, quarks and quarks, in case you're not familiar with that word, smaller than atoms. Who knows what's smaller than a quark, if there is anything. And so that's basically how water formed on the earth, and how the earth formed, this mysterious force that we theorize and call gravity, which smarter minds than my own have spent their lives analyzing and researching and all that, to call the force that brings pieces of rock together that are attracted when you have such a large body of mass in space. It creates this gravity field around it, I guess, is a way of saying it. And so when our galaxy was just like a disk of all kinds of pieces of rocks and dust and all that, minerals, they all became attracted, formed all the different planets. And it's kind of interesting, though, that all the planets and the moon, they're not attracted to themselves. Why doesn't the moon, why isn't it drawn to the Earth? Why aren't the other planets all drawn towards each other? I haven't done any research on that. That's something I would like to Google after this. But if large bodies like a planet attract, gravity is what pulls everything together, why isn't that still happening? Why are not all the different planets slowly being attracted to one another? Why are not, or isn't there any other bodies in space being drawn towards the planets? Well, I think one of the reasons why is there's not a lot of stuff in our neighborhood. There are, everything formed however many billions and millions of years ago. So there isn't a lot of dust and rocks and comets and things to anymore. It's everything already formed. Now, why the planets and the moon or the sun, why aren't they all attracted to one another by gravity? I don't really know. I don't know. I can't even begin to, distance. There's a lot of distance between the different planets, so that's part of it. Maybe there's some kind of gravity repulsion. Maybe it's the orbit, and they're too far apart to be attracted to one another. You know, maybe it's something simple like that. I don't know. But anyway, so this is where we live. And if it wasn't for all those building blocks, the pieces of the puzzle, so to speak, when the galaxy was first forming, and it wasn't for gravity, if it wasn't for gravity, we wouldn't be here. If it wasn't for the different, you know, if it wasn't for this position, this planet forming at such a perfect distance from the sun, we wouldn't be here. Any closer, it'd be too hot. Any further away, it'd be too cold. And life most likely would never have survived. So, it's quite interesting. So, this is what we call home. And it's a giant rock, pretty much, with a molten core. And it's covered mostly in water. And we've given it names and divided it up. And I'm not sure if that was such a good idea. I kind of wonder, and I've been wondering this since my 30s. In the past 20 years, is why aren't we, I mean, if I'm thinking this way, why aren't more of us thinking this way? Why aren't we, especially when we're always trying to promote unity and community, why haven't we come to the progressive realization that we're all one species, we're all human, so we should get rid of all these boundaries? I'm not saying get rid of the labels of, you know, we call this place Africa, and we call this area, this city, and that town, because those are kind of necessary. The labels that we give locations in society are somewhat necessary, so you know where to go to meet someone, to do a job, etc. Okay, we can't just say, you know, if you're living out in, living somewhere, you know, in China or Saudi Arabia or Africa, you can't just say, okay, meet me, you know, your friend lives a mile away. So what do you say? Meet me at the third tree across from the giant boulder? No. So we give all these places names. We call this city, this town, this street. We have everything down to a little small detail level, kind of pinpoint accuracy, I guess we could say. And that's fine. I'm fine with the labels, but I'm not fine in regards to the fact that we just haven't become truly united and have one government, one global currency, equality across the globe, and all that. There, we're still separated. We're separated by politics. We're separated by nationalism. We're separated by our heritage. We're separated by our language. We're separated by we're geographically separated by water and distance. We're separated by culture. We're separated by politics, and so on and so forth. So, you know, they always talk about, we're, you know, on one hand, I don't mean to get political, but on one hand, we're constantly talking about unity and come together, and our differences, you know, should bring us together, and all this stuff, right? But then on the other hand, We're all, the differences are what are keeping us separated. Now, I'm not saying we should abandon culture and things like that. And I'm I'm not really one for government. Not because I want to do illegal stuff. That's not why I want to get rid of government. I want people, us humans, to have more autonomy, more power, to own the fruits of our labor, to, you know, how... Anyway, so it's kind of a pointless discussion to have because government's not really going anywhere. But to live more like tribes, small tribes, as a philosopher Alan Watts thought, you know, we should probably live small groups that interact with one another, but now you have your small family and there's community and you take care of one another and all that. But in this society today, with how globally connected we are, why don't we have just one global currency? I don't think there's anything wrong with that. I know some people might, and I'm just... These are just thoughts. These are just harmless thoughts and ideas I'm putting out there. Now, if you have one global currency, it makes things a lot easier. If you have one global, say, minimum wage, that, you know, no one can be, everyone is kind of treated equally. I'm kind of the mind that there shouldn't be a wage at all, that whatever profits a company or corporation makes goes equally divided among all employees, and the rest of it, you know, goes towards, you know, maintenance and upkeep, whatever, but goes back into the community or something, I don't know. But that's me. Of course, that's why I'm not a business person. I could never own or run a business because I couldn't live with myself giving someone a minimum wage while I'm profiting the most and all that. I mean, I get it. I understand how it all works. Less experience means you don't get paid enough or paid the same as someone with more experience. But, you know, we can go on and on. I can start ranting like a madman about all that stuff, but I kind of am of the mindset that why not, when the money comes in, just divvy it all out equally, regardless of your experience. And yeah, I know that's, yeah, anyway, I mean, people would laugh and scoff at that idea, but you know, if... Yeah, so equality, that's true equality that everyone is trying to push for and everything. And, but there's we're never going to be truly united because everyone has their own idea on how they would like to live. You have a lot of people that... You have a lot of people that are... That kind of just keep to themselves... live mostly peaceful lives, and you have the opposite end of that spectrum, people that are not well, that try to cause others harm. There's just all kinds and all types, but I guess I'm speaking of somewhat of a utopia, an idealized version of society where everything is perfect, where there's no inequality, where there's plenty of community, where no one's alone, especially the elderly, where you can retire earlier, and things like that. But anyway, I'm not really here to get into anything like that so much, into the details. I really just came here to kind of ramble, go on some tangents. But yeah, that is this is where we live. And all kinds of, it's amazing all the different types of life forms on this planet. Really, it's like one big petri dish. All the different life forms. I mean, there's even life forms living in the Arctic. And I'm not talking about polar bears. I'm talking about, or even in the volcanoes. I think I saw some articles a few years ago about some bacteria or certain type of insect or just something very small living in the very absolute frozen either areas of the Arctic or the Antarctic, or it was in lava itself, the very hot, near lava, something like that. There's certain microbes or insects or whatever is smaller than an insect living in these extreme temperatures. And so, I mean, it's just amazing. And yeah. So that is the globe. That is where we live. And it just, I don't know what the chances are or the how slim the chances are or how small or how large the percentage is for a planet, another Earth-like planet to form somewhere in the universe. I think I saw some articles recently, over the past few weeks, prior to, you know, the date this video was published, that talked about other Earth-like, some Hubble telescope or scientists or astronomers possibly found one or two Earth-like planets or bodies somewhere deep in the universe. But you need the exact kind of situation. You need a sun, you need a star, and then you need the formation of a planet at just the right distance. So it's not too hot, not too cold. And then you need water. I think you need water, but you need molecules and, you know, can life form on a planet without water? I don't know, but yeah, so who knows if there, you know, who knows how expansive the universe is, you know, what shape it is. Does it go on forever? And who knows if there is another Earth-like, you know, I would imagine, you know, we could be the only life forms in the universe, or there are other planets in, or there are other galaxies, or solar systems, I guess. Solar system is probably the better word, where there is a planet orbiting a sun at just the right distance for life to form. And so who knows how many are out there. And in regards to the shape, this is another thought I'm not sure if you've had, but in regards to the shape of the universe, I'm not sure if they say it's like an oval, but I think they mention, and I say they, scientists and whatnot, talk about the universe is constantly expanding or something like that. So is there, what's out, so if that's true, so I'm trying to picture this. Just, does the universe go on forever? infinite stars, planets. Just if we had a spaceship and you were just able to travel forever, would you just keep going forever? Or is there a boundary? And so my question is, if the universe does not go on forever, so what's outside of that? There must be nothing outside of the universe. Or is the universe like, you know, there's lots of theories. Some of them are fantastic in nature, fantastical, fantasy. But you know how we are made up of, when you look inside of us, there's blood and there's a heart and there are blood cells and, you know, the smaller you go, the more you find these small, you find small things. I know what I'm trying to say. So what if the universe is just a small piece in something even much larger than the universe itself? So like, what if the universe is to whatever a red blood cell is to a human? I'm not saying the universe is inside of an organism, but what if the universe is inside of something? What if the universe is like a molecule? Because when you look at a human being, right, we appear to be large in size compared to a fly or a speck of sand. But when you start to look closer, you see we have a heart. And we look closer inside that heart, or inside of us, you see blood vessels. And you look closer and you see blood, and you look closer and you see red blood cells, and you know, closer, and you see molecules and whatever, atoms and quarks. So the more you begin to dig down to look closer and closer at life, you begin to see the small things, right? So you start off big, you go down to the very, you know, the very small, the infinitesimal. And when you start off very small, you come, you know, everything gets bigger the further away you get. So what if that's the same? What if the universe is like just a small molecule like thing in something that is much bigger than we can even imagine or fathom? Is that possible? Maybe, maybe not. Maybe the universe is just this whatever that's always expanding, but what's it expanding into? Yeah, so those are just kind of the thoughts that I have on occasion, but we will never get to know, because we are stuck here on this planet and we have enough things to take care of in regards to society in general, or just even our own lives. But who knows if we'll ever, who knows if we will ever create a space-faring vessel able to take us to the edge of the universe. Probably not. You would need a lot of energy. I'm sure brighter minds have theorized that you need some kind of space vessel that has, I don't know, a nuclear reactor, a fusion reactor, I don't know, to propel it through space and all that. So, and of course, it would need to be protected from the radiation in space, and then it would need to be protected from hitting all kinds of tiny particles. And, you know, how fast could you get it to go? And there's all kinds of things like that, which are a little bit above my pay grade. Yeah, so the planet And that's really it. I don't really have anything else to say. It is February, what is today? February 12th, 11th, something like that. And that's another thing. We call this, as of the date I'm making this video, it's the year 2023. And of course, that we call it 2023 based on the Gregorian calendar, I believe, that was invented 2023 years ago, or I don't know, or maybe not. You know, I don't know when the Gregorian, I don't know what the name of the calendar it is. I think it's the Gregorian calendar. But apparently my education from my youth from 40 years ago is starting to fail me. I mean, I don't really, you know, how often do you go and have a conversation with anyone in life ever about the name of the calendar? But my point is, I know it's, you know, My point is maybe we should use a different number to represent what year it is, because it's not, this isn't really the two, like, what year are we basing it off of? Where is this, the calendar still, we're still basing this off of the birth of Christ, Jesus Christ, I think, right? 2023 years after the birth of Christ, is that right, if I'm not mistaken? But I think at this point in time, we should, I mean, I understand, I get it, it's a number, it lets us know what year it is, because we've been able to pinpoint time and the passage of time with down to the very second based on the way the Earth rotates around the sun, orbits the sun, and the way the Earth rotates itself. So there's a constant speed, and it's, we call that 24 hours. We call that a day. And we break it down to minutes and seconds, and we say this is the year 2023, and that's fine. I mean, it's really not that big of a deal, whatever the number is. But I've just been thinking that maybe we should just be a little progressive minded and change the calendar year from, you know, 2000 years to something related to the age of the Earth, or the age of our species, or the age of the universe. And then say, let's say we're changing the calendar year to the age of the Earth. Now, I don't know what the age of the Earth is, so I'm just going to say, for sake of argument, let's say the Earth is, I don't know, 100 million years old. Okay? Maybe it's older than that, maybe it's younger than that, but just for sake of argument, okay? So we could just say this is the year 100 million and 23 years. So obviously you wouldn't want to write out 1 and then all the zeros and then 23. So you could just say 1M23. Something like that, right? Now, that's not much different than saying 2023. It's just a number. It's not that big of a deal. But I'm just talking in terms of a number that represents just introducing more logic. And that's kind of my thing. Have a number that represents something more based in science and logic and reason than just some arbitrary number that we came up with at some point. And this is just the year 2023. Yes, it's the year 2023 based on whatever calendar was adopted at whatever point in time in our recent past. But what is the year exactly? Is this the year for how long our species has been on evolved and on this planet? So should we say this is the year 30,023? So you could put 30K23 or 3K23, whatever. Or is this the year, should we base the year on how old the Earth is, how old the solar system is, the galaxy, the universe, right? So you gotta pick a number. But I think we should have a number that's more meaningful and significant and logical and it's based in logic and reason and science than whatever 2023 is based on. And that's just a thought. That's all, you know? So, anyway, this is February 2023. As of the time of this video was recorded and published. And we are here in North America, on the East Coast, but for other parts of the world as well, depending upon, I guess, if you're on the same latitude as, I mean, what I mean is if you're any further north or south, what I mean to say is winter is coming to an end. One more month and winter will be over. So there are other parts of the world that are on the same part of the Earth as we are here in North America. I'm not sure if that's latitude. You know, I'm not sure what goes around the Earth from side to side. Is that latitude or longitude? I'm not sure if you go from Arctic to Antarctic, is that longitude? And then latitude is around. Anyway, but if you're United States or perhaps China, Turkey, France, United Kingdom, that whole kind of area that is between the equator and further north, where it's too hot and between where it's too cold, you may experience the four seasons or three seasons, but most likely you will also have a summer and a winter. So if you're closer to the equator, you're going to have more of a constant temperature, constant summer. No winter, no spring, I don't think. If you're further north towards or further south towards one of the poles, you're going to have mostly winter, maybe a brief summer. You know, of course, there are on the other side of the equator, we have Australia and let's see, parts of South Africa, Brazil. So those areas may also have seasons, winter, spring, summer. So my whole point is winter is winding down, one more month to go, and it will be spring. And maybe it will be the same for you, and, you know, for others as well, if they live in other regions that had the same kind of temperate weather and seasonal changes, etc. And so far, We've had a very easy winter. Not a lot of snow, really. I think it may have snowed twice, but very light. I know it snowed once, but both occasions have not been anything remarkable. So, no, just a light dusting and a light covering. No need to shovel snow, not enough snow to make a snowman or anything like that. So besides that, I went to the dentist for the first 30 years of my life. I never really cared about taking care of myself. I took a lot for granted, and I didn't care about myself in like a negative way. Like, I thought bad about myself. I just didn't really care. I was young. And that's when you're young and I didn't have any physical ailments or disability. And I felt, sometimes you feel like immortal. I don't mean that in like I feel like I am a god. I don't mean any kind of egotistical, or you just don't think about that you're going to die, right? I mean, I'm sure that's every human being. You just don't think you're ever going to die. Especially when you're young. Your thoughts aren't really about any of that stuff. But I never really, I used to smoke here and there and abuse alcohol. And when I mean abuse alcohol, I mean just drink vodka straight and get drunk, or have too many beers and get drunk. That's what I mean. I was always a moderate drinker and smoker. I never drank like, 3 beers every day. But anyway, aside from that stuff, when it came to my teeth, I don't know how often I brushed. But back in the 80s, I mean, the further back in time you go, we weren't as health conscious as we are today. Today it's all about brush, frequently brush and floss. Stay hydrated. Make sure you eat your plenty of vegetables, grains and fruits and veggies. Watch your salt and cholesterol and the sugar and all that, and exercise and blah, blah, blah. But that wasn't really in the public mind or consciousness. There were, back in the 80s, in the 70s, I mean, there was, exercise tapes and workouts. There was lifting weights and stay-at-home moms watching Jane Fonda workout tapes and routines. But there weren't any gyms. I don't think there were any gyms back in the 80s. I don't remember. No one ever. I mean, you might have your weight set at home, but I don't think the gyms started opening, until the 2000s or late 90s, something like that. But my whole point is there wasn't an emphasis on maintaining your health or being health conscious. So we ate whatever. It didn't matter. We ate whatever without any regard to how it would impact. Pizza whenever you wanted. Sugary cereal, soda, candy bars, candy. We just ate whatever without much regard to how it might impact us. Impact our health. And so when it comes to teeth, my teeth especially, I don't really think, I don't know how often I brushed. But I had a lot of cavities in my youth, back in the back, in the molars, the teeth further in the back. I think they're called molars, right? So all four of the molars in the back of my teeth, and I believe all four in the top, were filled with mercury fillings. And that's really it as far as the cavities that I've had. But I didn't really get into the routine of, it wasn't until my 30s, I think. I mean, I would brush my teeth a couple times a week. I wouldn't floss much until I needed to. But definitely since my 30s and definitely since my 40s, I brush more and I floss at least twice a week, if not three. I don't floss every day, but I don't go more than 2 days without flossing. And so the only, aside from the cavities I had when I was a kid, the only other work I needed to have on my teeth was a root canal on one upper left tooth, the third tooth. Is it the second? Is it a molar? No, yeah, I think it's the, yeah, I think it's the second molar. So the second tooth from the back on my top left, I needed a root canal. Or at least when I went to this one particular dentist that I didn't like too much, and they actually went out of business. When I went there, they said I needed a root canal. And I don't know if my tooth ever hurt that bad, or if they were just trying to, it was shady and they're trying to get business out of me. But this place, this one dentist place, it was like America's Greatest Dentist, some cheesy name. And I just picked it because I didn't have a dentist to go to that I went to on a regular basis. And in this dentist, I just got a bad vibe because they also had a lot of advertisements and material around for things like Botox, lip injections, and I'm not sure what else they had. But I'm sitting here in the chair and I'm looking around me and I'm like, why is this dentist place trying to sell me, you know, Botox or whatever else they had? So I didn't get a real good vibe from that place, and a couple years later they're no longer there. So I don't know if I never needed a root canal and they suckered me into doing it for the business, or I really did need it. I don't know. But all I know is I have a little bit of a, I have a crown on that second from the last tooth on my top left. But ever since then, I have, and that was about, man, that was about 10 years ago, I think I had that crown put in. And for the first couple years, it was sore. It was very difficult to chew on that side, and I felt like they did a bad job. I don't know. It was just a sore point of aggravation. I'm not sure if I had that going on around the time I started this channel. Yeah, it was around then, I think, or a few years after. I can't remember. But I've been flossing ever since, and especially with me having to use my voice a lot here. And so I floss a lot and I brush more regularly, and I, ever since The root canal was the last issue I have had with my teeth, knock on wood. And so that's somewhat of a good thing. I'm not sure how long that will last, but we shall see. So I don't know about you and what your habits, your hygiene is like. I don't use any kind of tooth whitening. My teeth are somewhat yellow, stained yellow from, like I said, from smoking and from drinking coffee. I love coffee. I haven't been drinking much coffee though. Kind of gotten sick of it. I was drinking coffee regularly, more frequently, around the fall, summer, last year, most of last year. But over the last couple months, I think December, January, and now in February, I'm kind of sick of coffee. But smoking, drinking coffee, and not brushing my teeth frequently, just not having the best hygiene, kind of led to my teeth being somewhat yellow. And I don't really care about that. I mean, I probably should, I guess, because it's funny to see everyone with the white teeth, with the smiles and the white teeth. I'm like, how much, now, are there some people who have naturally white teeth that don't smoke, don't drink coffee? Probably. But as you get older, I'm pretty sure that most everyone's teeth start to age and become yellow. And I'm pretty sure starting in 30, when you're 30 years old, something like that. Now, I don't know. I don't know, like, how long people's teeth stay white. But all I'm saying, it's funny to see some older people, 40s, 50s, or whatever, with the white teeth. It just looks so fake. And I don't, you know, maybe because I'm a personality and I should be using white teeth whitener to make my teeth white so I look more professional and to make it look like I care about myself, I guess that's what I'm supposed to portray. But I don't use teeth whitener. I don't really care what anybody thinks about me. Regards to professional, unprofessional, I don't really care. I'm not here to keep up appearances or put on a show in that regard. So people can think what they want of me. I'm very comfortable in who I am and everything about me. So, but yeah, so teeth, the dentist, that's always, I could fall asleep, and I have dozed off on occasion when getting my teeth cleaned. Getting a deep cleaning, even though it's not the most comfortable thing, but just being in that chair, there's something about offices, doctor offices, hospital, dentist, the atmosphere is so very soporific, so very calming and sleep-inducing. Like, I've been in I don't know what it is, there's just, maybe it's because it's kind of quiet and there's a lot of like mumbling and quiet voices. But no matter if it's a dentist office, and I'm not sure if it's the same for you, a dentist office or any kind of place like that, and there's not a lot of noise, right? And you're sitting and you're waiting or whatever, it starts to, like, you could just fall asleep. You know, it could be an airport terminal. Could be a train station, you know. There's something about these certain places where there's not a lot of music, and there's, you know, people shuffling about, footsteps, and everything's kind of quiet in a way. It's not absolutely quiet, but there's no shouting, you know, and maybe there's no music, and it's just kind of, you have a chance, your brain has a chance to just have some silence, I think. And of course, you have the personal attention aspect from the dentist, which is, you know, maybe you get ASMR from the dentist. I'm not sure if I ever have. I don't really experience ASMR anymore myself. I haven't in like, I don't know, at least 5 years. But yeah, there's, of course, you're not getting personal attention in a hospital waiting room. But there's just something about being at these places where you know you have to wait and you don't have to do anything else. And you just, it just starts to put your head into a very relaxed kind of funk. And I know I could fall asleep at a hospital, in a hospital waiting area. You know, because you know you don't have anything else to do. And I don't know, there's just there's something very relaxing about being in a hospital. You know, except, you know, if you're the person that's not injured, if you're the person that's at a hospital because you're injured or in pain, obviously, it's not very sleep-inducing and relaxing because you're in pain. Or if you're at a, you know, the dentist because you have a major toothache. But if you're not in pain, those places are very relaxing and sleep-inducing for, you know, for the reasons I kind of mentioned. It's just not of, the sound is subdued, you know, or, you know, if people are talking, it's kind of, you know, they're not shouting and there's no music and et cetera, et cetera. Yeah, so dentist, doctors, and all that stuff, that all the things that we have to try to maintain a healthier lifestyle and to keep us going as long as we can. And I have some thoughts about that as to whether that's a good thing or not, because there's 8 billion of us on the planet. And I don't want to end here on a bad note, a sour note or anything. But there's 8 billion of us and counting. And while science and technology and medicine, all those advances are great in terms of helping someone heal a broken arm, giving an amputee artificial limb, but my what I'm driving towards is, my point is, we're keeping our species alive for much longer. And I'm not sure if that's a good thing when it comes, especially when it comes to the resources that it takes to feed us, for one, and all the space that we need. So the more and more of us that we stick around for a longer time and a longer age, and the more of us, just the more there are of us, I'm not, you know, whether it's population growth or just still sticking around because medicine and drugs and advances keep us around. You know, there's nothing really to keep us in check from growing and becoming, you know, 8 billion and counting. And what I mean is, any other species on the planet, they don't have the luxury of extending their lifespan with any medicine or anything. So all the insects and the bugs and the birds and the giraffes and the lions and the whales and the dolphins, they pretty much have a constant lifespan of however many years they're born, they live, and they die. And so nature kind of keeps them in check. They get hunted, they get eaten, disease, etc. But when it comes to us, we don't really have a natural predator. The only really natural predator we have, well, besides ourselves, when it comes to violence, is disease, cancer, and things like that. But even those we're trying to prevent. So On one hand, I think it's really good that we have advances in science and medicine to heal the illness and things like that. But on the other hand, I'm not so sure that's a good thing. Because there's 8 billion of us, and we need to eat. And how do you feed 8 billion people? Right? Just ask all the farm animals, the pigs and the cows and the chickens and the farmed fish raised on farms. So those are the resources I'm talking about. I'm not a part of any group. I'm not for or against. You know, I don't like the idea of factory farming, but I can see the need for it, because there's 8 billion of us. So if you get rid of factory farming and you want smaller farms, you're going to produce smaller amounts of meat and things like that. So you're going to have, what are you going to do? Starve people? So if we get rid of factory farming of the cows and the pigs and the chickens and you want them, I mean, do you get rid of farming altogether? Shouldn't cows and pigs and chickens just live like every other animal on the planet? Should they be farmed? So if we get rid of farming, how are you going to feed everybody? Now, I'm an omnivore, and I enjoy meat and fish and vegetables and everything, right? So you can't control what people can or can't eat. So that's number one. Number two is, if we do get rid of farming, just hypothetically, and we say, just let the pigs and the cows and the chickens roam free, like giraffes, like dolphins in the water, whatever, and we don't farm them. Okay, so what's the alternative? How are we going to get the iron that we need and the protein that meat provides? Because we're omnivores. You can't just eat vegetables. And you know, not everyone can. And not just that. It's not just, you know, you can't force people. That's a lot of problems with societies. People trying to tell everybody how to do this and how, what you should do and what you shouldn't do. So it's, I could sit here and get into a hole. But my point is, without going any further and to bring this episode to a close, my point is, I just don't think, while I think medicine and science and technology is great for healing people and all that, and the not having to die of diabetes and high cholesterol, you take pills for that. On the other hand, I don't think it's so great because we're sticking around longer than maybe we should. Perhaps human beings' lifespan should be 40 years or 30 years. Maybe 60, 70, 80 years is not good. You know, like I said, when it comes to, when you start talking about the resources that we use up and the, you know, the deforestation and the destruction of the planet that we cause to build more farms and more housing. So I'm not trying to make anyone feel bad or make you feel bad if you're younger, okay? But it's just a thought that I have on a pretty frequent basis, especially when it comes to the constant, you know, the human beings are so great. You know, we're always trying to, you know, it's all about us, you know, the selfies. And I'm a movie star, and I'm a rock star. And just the importance, the overinflated self-importance that we have when we are just as insignificant or as, you know, significant as any other creature on the planet. You know, so anyway, so that's the thoughts that I have. So, I mean, there's no answer, really. I mean, unless you can come up with a viable man-made meat substance that's like meat, fake meat, that has all the nutrition, the iron, and the protein of real meat, and you can make a factory without harming animals, then I'm fine with that. I'd be fine with a cube of meat of a just factory, you know, genetically engineered, whatever, meat cube. This is your protein iron cube. And it's, you know, some of them are like steak, some are like pork. You know, I'd be fine with that. And that way the pigs and the cows and the chickens can just be free to be pigs and cows and chickens without being farmed. But that's not really... For me, ideally, I think hunter and gatherer society was peak society. We when humans, way back when, we were born, we lived, we hunted only what we needed. We didn't farm. And then we died and we melted back into the earth. And the earth was a healthy place. But then we learned about agriculture and farming and industry. And we kind of became a plague. This is the kind of thought and conversation that I didn't want to end up having at the very end here. But here we are. So we are a plague to the planet. There, I said it. I don't really. You know, maybe we'll have that more detailed discussion another time, but I gotta end it here. So that's gonna do it. So thanks for joining me. Thanks for tuning in. And I hope to speak to you next week. And if you have any kind of, you know, topic or comment you'd like to make, and, you know, I can kind of squeeze it in, bring it up, because I'll be telling a story once a month, but then every other Tuesday, I'll be talking about whatever. And so, yeah. So until then, take care, stay well, be safe, and I hope to see you in another video real soon. Take care, and so long for now.